Hello, I'm Bill Curtis for Investigative Reports. In 1990, there were 2 million fires in America. One of every 20 of those fires occurred in New York City. The men and women who race to fight these blazes are the heart of the country's biggest and busiest fire department. Like firefighters everywhere, they put their lives at risk just by showing up for work. And they fight the enemy they call the Red Devil with a passion for their jobs that verges on religion. It's a business that requires precise teamwork, split-second decisions, and the kind of selfless heroism we're used to reading about only in legends. I have no ambition in this world but one, and that is to be a fireman. The position may, in the eyes of some, appear to be a lowly one. But we who know the work which a fireman has to do believe his is a noble calling. Our proudest moment is to save lives. Under the impulse of such thoughts, the nobility of the occupation thrills us and stimulates us to deeds of daring, even of supreme sacrifice. Each day, somewhere in New York City, firefighters are confronted with the specter of today's urban decay. Buildings are old and overcrowded. Hundreds of others have just been abandoned. The personal risks of firefightings in these buildings are enormous. It's not uncommon for firefighters to get there just after a small blaze has turned into a raging inferno. Many of these fires are not caused by overheated electrical wiring or careless smoking. They're the work of arsonists. Although uninhabitable by most, these structures have become homes for the homeless, or the drug dens of the addicted. For the firefighters, that adds to the danger.
And then it just started rising. Then just fire just started popping out of nowhere.
It started flying.
Then
it started going up to the
spreading over.
Quick. And the fire started and we saw all these crackheads coming out from the back of the back.
So
of
we
the
ran and got the fireman.
We have 3 towel ladders in operation, 8 hand lines, fire is knocking you down.
10-4, status of the fire?
Still doubtful.
10-4, 1-7 item?
It's a vacant building. The fire started in the rear and it came up the whole back. It's collapsed in most of the interior. So we really can't put anybody inside the building. So we're putting an exterior operation. They use the saws to cut the wood off the front of the window so the towel out of bucket streams can get in there and put out the fire. It's going to be a prolonged operation because the building's so dangerous. Okay?
Whether they're fighting a high-rise in Manhattan, a brownstone in Brooklyn, a frame house on Staten Island, a storefront in Queens, or a rundown apartment complex in the Bronx, these battlers of blazes rarely complain. For them, it is part of the job. Almost unanimously, they say they love it.
Yo, 75!
So what do you got here?
It's probably a third alarm by now. So we got here on the second. We're operating in the throat for, what, about a half hour?
Seems like a little longer than that.
They're going to get it knocked pretty good now because they're opening up the top floor. Going through the roof and they're opening up, so it won't be too much longer.
It looked like it took a little bit of beat.
We were up for a pretty good time up there.
You like the job?
Oh, yeah. Great job. We want to do anything else.
Lift, right, lift.
It all begins here, boot camp, probationary fire school. They call it the Rock. Here, probies or student firefighters are taught the basic skills, physical conditioning, and stamina needed to withstand the rigors of the job. Instructors are determined to instill in them the insight and mental awareness they will need to react instinctively under extremely strenuous conditions. The training is arduous. At times, it seems it will never end. They're told the most always give 120%. But at every instance, at every fire, it is brother relying on brother to get the job done and, above all, survive. And after hours and hours of practice, the hope is these rookies will eventually gain enough experience so they one day will turn their new skills into an art. But in spite of all the training, no one will be fully prepared for the inevitable tragedy and sadness of lives that cannot be saved. For what can be learned here are only the fundamentals. It will be up to the individual to develop the determination to find a way through the most difficult situations. At the Rock, these future firefighters are being born into a brotherhood that is steeped in tradition. Later, in the field, they will be baptized by the cruelty of fire. After they graduate, they'll be fighting real fires where there are no timeouts. The luxury of making mistakes will be gone. It will not be until their first fire that they will begin to understand the importance of what they are learning now and the reality that they have much more to learn. The instructors have a phrase they drill daily into the probies. Let no man say his training let him down. Nearly every day, at least one contingent of New York City's fire department is faced with an emergency they call Red Devil. Within minutes of the alarm, truckies are opening up, engines are stretching lines, and the course for the battle is being put in motion. Quick and decisive actions are needed to get the situation under control. There's no time to sit back and contemplate the next step. What appears to some civilians as chaos is really a carefully planned attack drawn up by seasoned firefighters. Split-second decisions, which involve all forces on hand, must be made. Instant command decisions and clear communications to all units are vital to the task. And those who carry out the orders know relying on each other is crucial in keeping the destruction from spreading.
Okay, 206 and then 260.
Who's next up?
206 and
209. Okay. All right, we got 325, 259, and 292. Right. We got three lines over here.
Right.
And we're going to bring in 206, right?
Right.
Okay.
All right, okay. 238, get to.
Okay. 128.
To them, the road to accomplishing their mission is simple. Locate, confine, and extinguish.
We have about a 100 by 100
one-story commercial building. We call them tax pays. I guess the fire looks like it started in the, I really don't know right now. Looks like it might have started in the boutique. It got up in the cockpit, went left and right. Guys forced entry, got in, knocked the fire down, pulled the ceilings down, cut the roof, and we stopped it from spreading to the building behind it. So we're going under control in about 5 minutes, as soon as I release some of the companies, okay?
The Bronx. There are 9 battalions, 31 engine companies, and 27 ladder companies that cover 42 square miles of densely populated area here. About 1.2 million call it home. The Bronx was heavily damaged by the arson rages of the late 1960s and 70s, but even today, it remains nearly as active as it did then. And although the Bronx is one of the smallest boroughs of New York City, it rates second in the number of fires each year. Now, some of the fire companies here are said to be among the busiest in the world, fighting large numbers of the city's most spectacular blazes. The main reason the Bronx firefighters are so busy is the massive number of vacant buildings within its boundaries. Hundreds of empty structures, some barely standing, are the result of years of neglect, decay, and previous fires. It's not unusual for fires to break out in the same buildings time after time, especially in the multi-story structures where there's nothing to stop quick-spreading, deadly smoke.
Place is all rotten. Probably been vacant for 15 or 20 years. Dry rotted, weathered on. Not untypical of buildings in the Bronx.
Brooklyn, southeast of Manhattan, the most highly populated of all New York's boroughs. Here there are 19 battalions, 66 engine and 39 ladder companies. They cover 73 square miles with a population of 2.3 million.
Four hands operating Bucks 935 with the address 532 Gates Avenue. Affirmative, they have been notified. Your rescue is coming from Fulton and Malcolm X also, by the way.
8-10-4.
Okay, the time is now 1541.
Firefighters here are the busiest in the city. They answer more alarms each year than any other borough. With a population larger than most major cities, Brooklyn has seen many changes in recent years. Most dramatic, once quiet neighborhoods have now become favorite targets for arsonists.
It was a small 1075 fire where we had the, looks like it started in the couch and just started rolling around the room. And the brothers came in, did a good job, knocked it down, made the search, found nobody, about to take up with history.
Other sections of Brooklyn have kept firefighters busy for years. Three of these, Bushwick, Brownsville, and East New York, have suffered the same devastation as the hardest hit areas of the Bronx. These days, firefighters and their equipment in action is an all too common sight on borough streets.
This is probably the workingest neighborhood in Brooklyn. The occupied structural fires that we have are probably the highest in probably one parts of the city, mostly. Yeah. So the work in this area has maintained a steady pace. And a fire in the kitchen, pretty good job, heavy smoke. We made a search of the bedroom foyer, proved negative, no extension.
In population, Staten Island is the city's smallest borough, with about a half million residents. Its firefighting manpower is also the smallest, with 3 battalions, 17 engine companies, and 12 ladder companies. Unlike the city's other boroughs, Staten Island consists mainly of private homes. There are smaller apartment complexes here and many family-owned businesses. When the Verrazano Narrows Bridge was built in 1964, Staten Island's population underwent a dramatic increase, and so did its firefighting manpower. And since it's an island, the borough's units must respond repeatedly to distress calls from people in the water. An entire company of firefighters assigned to the island is made up of certified divers for just such emergencies. Braving treacherous waters, the company known as Rescue 5 is credited with saving hundreds of lives.
Information available upon request. 4-6, you have 3-2-1, rescue number 4, okay.
Queens is the largest in size of all the city's boroughs. Located just east of Manhattan, its population stands at 2 million. It is protected by 9 battalions, 51 engine companies, 29 ladder companies. Although a good percentage of structures here are made up of private homes, there are a large number of apartments and storefronts. Also, both Kennedy and LaGuardia airports fall under the jurisdiction of its firefighters. In the past 10 to 15 years, there's been an alarming increase in the number of fires in Queens. Much-needed additions in firefighting manpower have followed. Today, some of Queens' companies are among the busiest in the city. The growing fear is that Queens will see a repeat of the arson battles which have so devastated the Bronx and Brooklyn. One reason for concern is the rapidly growing problem of overcrowding. With an increase of illegal immigrants, once private homes are suddenly becoming illegal multiple dwellings. 5 or 6 families are now living in homes once occupied by one. Newly installed steel bars on windows have become the firefighters' nightmare. The result of all this, fire deaths in Queens are soaring. Manhattan. During the day, the population reaches more than 2 million. Fire service here, 12 battalions, 44 engine, and 32 ladder companies. Their responsibility, high-rises, lofts, tenements, theaters, all crammed into 23 square miles. Midtown, Harlem, Chinatown, Inwood, Soho. Just a few of the many neighborhoods of Manhattan. Manhattan firefighters have fought some of the most serious and deadly fires in New York City's history. Although high-rise fires are now an everyday occurrence, they remain the most feared. Their large floor areas with oven-like temperatures pose the greatest dangers a firefighter can face, because they're an ever-present tragedy in waiting. New York's firefighters spend extra hours attempting to become experts at bringing them under control. quickly. Recently, FDNY celebrated its 125th year as a paid fire department. The celebration was called 125 Years of Tradition. Although the city, like anything else, has changed a lot since 1865, the firefighters' traditions have changed very little. They've gone from horse-drawn to diesel vehicles, from wooden to metal ladders, from bells to computers. But the spirit, the dedication, the mission, and the bravery of the firefighter remains.
It's a very important moment for me. It's a lot of nostalgia. You think about 32 years that I was part of this service, and hopefully for another four or five. And I just think of what happened and where we were and where we're going. And we look at all this apparatus, and you think of all the people that made up this department, what it all means to us. It's a very, very, very emotional moment for me.
To me, it means a great deal because I put 33 years in this department, so part of that history is mine. And the department itself is alive and well. We're doing well. We're progressing. And the people of the city of New York have an organization that can be very well proud of.
No matter what changes have occurred within and around the department, when the call comes, New York's firefighters want people to know they will be there.
The question is, someone asked me what it means to me to be a fireman in New York City. Well, to me, it's tradition. I have relatives that were in the fire department. I was a police officer before I was a fire department. It makes it kind of extra important to me because both of them are emergency services, but this to me is more rewarding. I love the New York City Fire Department. My family has been in it for many years. I love what we do, and I think that the people of the city of New York love what we do.
Well, firefighters are incredibly brave human beings because they know things that we don't know, and we have to learn the things that they know in order for us to survive. For example, we always believe that fires are nice and light and homey, and Robert Redford runs through the flames and picks up the furniture and he saves people. But in a real fire, when a firefighter goes into it knowing what he's going to face, it's totally black. He can't see his hand in front of his face. The heat is so intense that if the firefighter stands up, it'll melt his helmet and burn the back of his head off. And he could die if that mask breaks or in any way becomes defective. In a fire, you really don't have any time. It's instant reaction. I mean, you just can't turn back. So you have a group of men here who may be sitting around a firehouse having fun and enjoying life to the outward appearance, but when they go into a fire, you put your life on the line every time. And that's the most scary thing that you can face. So when they call them the bravest, you got to buy it, because if you know anything about fires, they are the bravest.
Extra engine and truck, occupied building, people trapped above the fire. These choice words used by the officer in charge will let the dispatcher know the urgency of the request. Companies on the scene are already heavily involved. Six stories, 20 or more apartments, 100 people or more, and a dangerous fire. An aggressive interior attack becomes the necessary plan of action. On arrival, the firefighters must know instantly what is essential to change the course of destruction. Their primary objective is to save lives, but they all know the simple truth. Their lives are always at risk. Rushing in while others are trying to get out, beating the red devil, and at the same time to do it without loss of life or serious injury. This is their goal, but they are prepared for the worst. Last year, these firefighters battled over 2,000 working building fires in New York City. That's six working fires a day.
Now, when we pulled up, it was fires blowing out about three floors.
I got 75
right from the first floor, a lot of people were hanging out all the windows, and made it up to the roof, took the bulkhead door, and saw that the looked like the interior stairs were torched. The whole thing was scorched, all the way up, the window frames were going, and there were people all coming out the rear.
On arrival at the building, we had heavy fire blowing up the face of the building and up the interior stairs. Numerous people on the fire escapes. It's only through the efforts of the men that nobody got killed at this fire.
1-8 to Division 7K.
It's amazing.
Okay, we found a lot of black spotting going up the pipe recesses of the third floor. We've opened up the ceiling and we're going to hit at the line. There's no visible fire or anything. Recommend under control.
All right, 10-4. Fire is apparently an arson fire. The marshals have a suspect that they're hunting down. He's previously set fires to motorcycles in the same building. Fire went up the hallway, burnt through a door on the third floor, got into that apartment. It got into several apartments. Heavy smoke condition. And again, it's a miracle nobody was killed.
David N. Dinkins.
Thank you very much. As mayor, it is my privilege to represent the people of our city as the Fire Department of New York salutes the bravest and the best of the bravest. I'm pleased and proud to add my voice to the chorus of praise and tribute to the gallant firefighters of FDNY, the men and women who proudly serve in the greatest fire department in the world. For the medals earned and bestowed at this ceremony, there were in fact at least 80 persons rescued from fire, a building collapse, drowning, or some other imminent danger by these medalists. Yet when I think of the 80 we were able to save, my thoughts still go back yet again to the 87 we were not able to save. They died on the 26th of March at a misnamed place called the Happy Land Social Club. With even more vicious irony, they died in the third worst fire in New York City history, on the anniversary date of the second worst fire at the infamous Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. In the early hours of that morning, a fire was set, apparently, deliberately, and maliciously set on the first floor of that club. Within minutes, the Happy Land Social Club had become a place of unspeakable horror. For 87 people trapped inside, there was no escape. I've been in public life for a quarter century. I've had occasion to witness many tragedies. But the sight of that fire is perhaps the single most tragic thing I have ever witnessed. The sight of those bodies lined along the walls like so many wax figures, the realization of the panic and the pain they must have suffered in their last moments will remain with me for the rest of my life. As will my endless admiration for the women and men of this department, who again and again hurled themselves into such deadly situations. So I'm here today to join in bearing witness to the bravery of these firefighters. I'm here to thank you all on behalf of each and every New Yorker for all you have done and all you are doing for us. And I'm here to express my fervent wish that God watch over you and your family. In this audience today is Alethea Ann Cruz. Cruz was aboard U.S. Air Flight 5050 when it crashed on takeoff at LaGuardia Airport last September 20th. She wanted to come back here today to see the man who rescued her from that wreckage, the man who saved her life. She wanted to see her hero receive the James Gordon Bennett Award, the oldest and highest award for valor that the department gives. May I ask that Mrs. Cruz join us up here as Lieutenant Gerard Mertler receives the first of his awards today. It is my honor, sir.
Pleased to be able to be here with Jerry to present him with my award, for he is my hero. This award says, presented to Jerry Murtha, my hero. Everlasting thanks for your bravery and heroism in rescuing me from Flight 5050. Because of you, I am alive today.
Medal Day, it's just a great day. It's a day that we reflect on what a lot of firefighters have done throughout the year. I'm just one of the lucky guys that are getting recognition, but there's 10,000 other guys that deserve the pat on the back like everybody else does.
Our next medal, the Emily Driver Mary B. Warren Medal, is awarded to firefighter Michael J. Milner of Rescue Company 4. This medal is awarded for his heroic actions at great personal risk in the rescue of a trapped woman from a plane crash in Flushing Bay near LaGuardia Airport.
The medal to me is a lifelong dream, and I have to say that because of officers I've worked with and firemen that have helped me, it's made this possible for me today, and I'm not only quite proud of myself, but everybody that's worked with me has helped me to make this day for me.
Our next award is the Dr. J.W. Goldenkranz Medal, this year awarded to firefighter Daniel M. Monahan of Ladder Company 38. Firefighter Monahan effected the rescue of an unconscious woman from an all-hands fire at 2081 Washington Avenue in the Bronx on December 7th, 1989.
Today was probably the best thing that ever happened to me. It's just too bad everybody else in the fire department can't be honored like this. I can't ask for anything more than have this happen to me today.
Our next award is the Walter Scott Medal, this year awarded to firefighter William H. Quick of Rescue Company 4. Firefighter Quick performed his heroic act at great personal risk at a building collapse at 1509 First Avenue, Manhattan on December 6, 1989.
He just complained that his right shoulder was hurting a little bit. You know, he goes, my right shoulder, it's severe pain. You know, just try to get me out as fast as you can. I said, Jimmy, run away, we're trying. Like I said, I felt bad. I had to tell him every 10 minutes. The 10 minutes kept going longer and longer. If we worked fast, the whole thing would have came down on top of us, and then we would have been trapped.
Bless these brave and courageous firefighters whom we honor today. We live in a world with so much selfishness and mediocrity. Let the inspiring, heroic, life-saving acts of our firefighters focus our attention on the most noble deeds that daily surround us. Their acts of heroism are a striking testimony to the great qualities of the human spirit. May their bravery bring credit and admiration to themselves, to this fire department, and to this great city of New York. And finally, Lord, grant that all of us may realize the great sacrifices at which our safety is assured. I ask you this in all love and humility. Amen.
Hey, morning, Billy. How you doing?
Yeah, you get right positions.
Yeah, you got the forcible entry irons.
All right.
And I want you to check the forcible entry masks pass along. Something the matter with it.
Okay.
Check the oil in the hose tool, the gas, and check the saws, because they were acting up. One of them was acting up.
One of the most rewarding feelings about being a firefighter is realizing you are part of a team. Each individual knows their part, whether it's in the firehouse or out on the street. Each one has an assignment. Each one knows in the heat of battle that assignment could change at a moment's notice. It's part of being on the team. Between alarms and firehouse duties, some firefighters will spend their time studying for an upcoming promotional exam. Hard work and dedication are only part of their jobs. The learning process never stops.
Well, it's a commitment. You really have to put your time in into it. It's something that's not can't be taken for granted. Can't be lax about it. Most guys for this exam they study 2 years. This is my second time around. So I try to put in as much time as possible. I mean, I just had my fourth child, and things are busy at home, so I take as much time in the firehouse to study, and now I'm coming in 2 hours before each tour and trying to plug in some time there. Definitely be worth it. I'll put the time in now.
Well, it's one of the proudest days of my career in a fire department. I certainly waited a long time for this promotion. I thought it would never come, and I was like very anxious, very nervous, right up until this morning. I mean, they gave us our badges on Monday. They told us we could go exchange badges and ID, but I said, I won't believe it until they ask you to raise your right hand and they swear you in. Because, you know, many, many hours I just sat down and read and didn't talk to anybody. But it's a really good day.
If there is one characteristic firefighters hold above all else, it is brotherhood. Bravery and love, say the firefighters, is what sets them apart from other professions. The result, many times, is heroism.
I'm glad I'm here in Brooklyn. My father was a fireman for about 31 years, and he worked in Brooklyn, and Ladder Company 108. And I feel it's like a family tradition on the job. To me, this is the best job in the world. And I really enjoy being a fireman and helping the people around here. And that gives me the greatest satisfaction in the world, is helping people. And I believe everybody on this job gives 100%, even more.
One night in December, I was working a night tour and was bringing this little girl down the ladder. She was about 4 years old. She was hugging and squeezing my neck. I mean, it was a very serious fire. Once I brought her down to the bottom of that ladder, I knew that this is what I wanted to do. Children are special. All people are special. The job of a firefighter is special. It's not a job, it's a career, it's a calling.
These firefighters are constantly attempting to impress on the public one message. Their commitment to the city and the neighborhoods is real. They always want to be there when they are needed.
I think firemen are the most professionally unique people in the world because in any kind of emergency situation, they help, you know, they help you quicker than any kind of police or any other emergency service that we have in New York. You know, because I mean, one time I had got, you know, had a big gash on my head, you know. They came first, you know. It was just unique because, you know, firemen is just, they're just there when you need them, you know. They're more, you know, they're like equipped like EMS. And they take care of the scene like the police, but they're, you know, it's just put in the middle. But I think they should be put on top, though. That's the way it should be. They should be put on top.
I've seen a lot of films about the fire department over the years, and a lot of them are really interesting, and it's nice to see, you know, you see the flames coming out the window, and they show the film in the firehouse, and they look like a lot of nice guys just hanging around, kidding around, get along real well, we eat, and everybody thinks of us like that, but I don't think anybody has really any idea what it means to be a fire, to be inside a fire building, putting out a fire. You can't explain that, it can't be done, and I don't even know if you could get it on film. It's a unique experience, and that's what it's all about. It doesn't happen all the time. You know, we wait around a lot, but people see us that we don't do a lot. But when we do that, it's very unique. And I don't know how you would be able to describe it. And that's what we're really all about. not just a lot of happy guys, which we are, because we like what we do. But it's really putting out fires.
The road is long.
Happy Land Social Club fire in March of 1990 was the most deadly act of arson in American history. But without a similar tragedy in 1991, the number of fire fatalities was actually down last year in New York City. The firemen like to call themselves the brothers, but one in every 26 American firefighters is in fact a sister. And although they make up less than half of 1% of the New York force, women firefighters are on the front lines every day, risking their lives in the line of duty.